Good morning, everybody. That's a bit of a macabre start to the morning. Of course, the nasal passages of a giraffe greet you on this dawn safari. Well, it's a semi-safari in this particular incident because we are in the studio tent and there is a magnificent morning burgeoning behind us. My name is James Hendry. On camera today, we have for the very first time Brian Joubert. Careful, Brian, you're going to bash your 6'4" head. And what I wanted to come outside and show you very quickly was the sun coming up and, of course, the magnificence of Eugene Bass as he walks across the screen. Hello, Eugene. He didn't know that was going to happen to him. Out on walk today, we've got Stefan, and he is being accompanied by the diminutive Wim Dorenbrak, who's basically playing pack donkey today, carrying that enormous pack. And then on drive, the inimitable and irascible Brent Leo Smith, who's knocking about trying to find what has been going on during the night. As we woke up this morning, we heard many hyenas calling. They were going, whoop, weren't they, Brian?
They were indeed.
Yes, they were doing that. And what they were shouting at, we're not sure. So there was a huge amount of activity. So Brent's going to go and investigate what was going on there. There were some lions calling, but they were calling generally very far to the north of us. So I'm not sure that we're going to be lucky enough to see them. Now, what I would like you to come and have a look at, quite apart from me talking nonsense and the rather macabre look at a giraffe's inner nasal passages, no one should have to see that in the morning, really.
No.
No. What we have here is a number of dry grasses. Now, of course, we're into the middle of the winter, and it's always a little nostalgic looking at the golden grasses because they are indeed very beautiful, but they do mean that there's very little for the animals to eat. And what I, in sort of line with this, what I wanted to show you was this dung. And this is impala dung, and it's relatively fresh. It was from last night, but it's dry, completely dry. And it just shows you how the animals of this area have a remarkable ability to reabsorb any form of water from what they eat. So despite the fact that we are into a drought and there's not a great deal of, moisture for anything to eat, despite that fact, the animals are surviving. And they do that because they have these special adaptations. Their kidneys suck out just about every piece of water that they can, so the urine is very concentrated, and the digestive tracts will just about, well, they'll take absolutely any moisture there is from the food that they eat. Just a quick idea of these are still very beautiful grasses, of course. This is called a cat's tail, and you can just see one or two seeds left. Can you see the seeds there? There we are. And those seeds will be dispersed by the wind. You can feel a breeze blowing through our little tent as we sit here. It's about 11 degrees Celsius, which I've forgotten in Fahrenheit, about 55, I think, in Fahrenheit. And then one more here. I really like that one. That one is, I think it's called a kinokloa when it's, well, all the time, but you can see all of its seeds have been scattered in the autumnal winds. Also scattered in the autumnal winds, of course, my hair, and I don't wear, I wear a hat because I have no hair, but a much braver man than I is out on foot, also slightly hairless, Mr. Stefan Winterboer.
Good morning from the beautiful Juma Private Game Reserve and that wonderful sunrise that you're watching over there. This is the Bushwalk. I'm Stef Winterboer and we are on camera today with Wim Doornbach and we are hot on the trail of that elephant that you managed to see last night from the tent just before we ended up finishing off the bushwalk. We decided that we'd come and look for him today. But before we do that, we've got one of Mother Nature's little secrets here. Have a look at this guy. That is a bug. Now what I mean by bug, I don't just mean that it's any sort of scary looking insect. It's a bug from the insect order Hemiptera. And it's a special type of bug. It's called an assassin bug. Now bugs are best described as having sucking and piercing mouthparts. And this little bug has got a particularly, this particular bug has got a particularly elongated proboscis that you can see extending from his tiny little head curled up underneath his face. He uses that to stick into the heads of grasshoppers, crickets, and locusts, and he will assassinate them. That's where he gets his name from, the assassin bug, from that dagger-like proboscis that comes out of his face there. Now, they can actually do some damage. One was in a bathtub that I had once when I was a little boy, and I picked it up, and he ended up extending his little proboscis and jabbing it into my hand. And I must say, a centimeter, so half an inch or so of proboscis sticking into your hand burns. You see, if you can get it into profile that you can actually see it, you can maybe see it curled underneath there. Maybe if I turn a little bit more. Sorry, Liam, I'm playing with your focus here, but sorry. There we go. You can see it in profile there, curled up underneath his face. Just look at the colors on this guy. Now, the colors that you can see there, the red, black, and white, and some little bit of yellow, if my eyes don't deceive me this morning, they are called aposomatic coloration, or that is called aposomatic coloration. And that is a clear display to anybody who wants to eat this guy that he is distasteful. Now, that could be because he's actually, he specializes in sucking the juices from insects that themselves feed on poisonous plants. And in so doing, quite often they can absorb those toxins. They don't get affected by those toxins. They can metabolize those toxins, and they can actually make it part of their own chemistry and make themselves distasteful. So while he doesn't feed on plant material that is toxic, he will feed on animals that are toxic. And that is why he's having this clear display. When you are distasteful, it is always best in the insect world to show other insects that you are. The reason for that is that he doesn't want to be mistaken for being tasty when he's not, and then be picked up anyway and smashed around by a bird on a branch. He's just starting to wake up now. The bug, Hemiptera assassin bug. Awesome. You don't see too many of them around at the moment. This time of the year, actually this year, has been quite unique in the fact that there hasn't been that many insects around. So Red has just asked me if these little guys are venomous. No, Red, they're not venomous. So venomous and poisonous, two different things. Venomous is an animal that has poison that they can inject into you, basically, or venom, an enzyme that they can inject into you. Poisonous is when you yourself, as an organism, are distasteful, like a toxic plant or a toxic compound that you protect yourself with. This little guy here, not venomous, he doesn't inject any poison. He's got this long spear that he basically jabs into his prey and then sucks them dry, kills them that way. And he himself looks to be toxic. I don't know if he is. He's just displaying these colors, those aposomatic coloration that we were talking about now. So he may be or may not be. I'm not going to put him in my mouth to try. These little insects have some of the most marvelous ways of metabolizing basic compounds into really dangerous stuff. So I wouldn't be able to tell you. I'm not going to tell you. I'm just saying he looks it because of that coloration that he's got there. Quite interesting, very bold pattern, excuse me, that caffeine shake again, making it difficult for you to see. There you go. Right, and while we carry on with our bushwalk, James is in probably the most perfect place on the reserve to see a sunrise.
I'm also, of course, in the perfect place to be investigating what Steph has been looking at. What an unbelievable assassin bug that was. And I've just been sort of looking up the various different kinds of assassin bugs that we get here. But the sun peeped its head up over the eastern horizon before I was able to discover anything that Steph didn't tell you. Isn't that wonderful? That's the winter sunrise, of course. And in summer, all the way off to the right there is where the sun comes up. And I just find that always astounding, that the sun can move that far over the horizon during the course of a year and during a season. It will probably move, you can see the two trees that it's come up between, and it will probably move to the right-hand edge of that last tree on the left-hand side of your screen, and then it will turn around and come back again. And that will happen on the 22nd of June, when we will have our longest night, and most of you in North America and various parts of the Northern Hemisphere will have your longest day. And for us, that's kind of, well, we're on the downhill slope from winter, but you can see that it's just not that cold here. I mean, I think it's unusually uncold here. But it's much colder if you happen to be driving on a vehicle, and if you happen to be Brent Leo Smith, who doesn't drive very slowly, it can be even colder still. So let's go and find out from Brent what his plans for the morning are.
Welcome to Safari Live. As James has so kindly introduced me already, I am Brent Leo Smith. I have Gerard on camera with us today, and he's an interviewee who's trying out. So quite exciting to have a new cameraman. You know, we get tired of our old cameraman from time to time, so it's always nice to have someone new on the back. So at the moment, I am searching for the Nkuhuma ladies. Now, if you're not sure who the Nkuhuma ladies are, they're our dominant pride of lions around here. And Jamie had them not too far away from camp last night. So I am scurrying and searching about. I haven't found any tracks yet, so I'm hoping they're just lying up at a waterhole, going to make life easy for me this morning. If we get no luck in this area, I think I'm going to go have a look for Queen Karula down along the southern boundary. I've already spoken to Ephraim from Cheetah Plains, and he's going to let me know if there are any cheetah tracks about. But it is an absolutely glorious morning, and I'm really excited to be out, and hopefully we can find you some wonderful creatures out in this dawn. Now, as we keep quiet and listen, the birds are starting to wake up, but what I'm actually listening for is the roar of a lion or the snort of an impala that spotted a lion. But unfortunately, just Cape turtle doves and the odd Franklin calling just yet. Oh, and a canary. But we're not looking for canaries right now, we're looking for lions, so let's carry on. So the lions spent most of their night in and around camp, and we could hear them throughout the night. You could hear animals alarm calling, you could actually hear that wonderful sound of a lion roar. Now, I've checked well up to the west, no sign of them moving out that way, and no sign of them on the northern boundary, which is good. So I've done a big loop, and now I'm making a smaller loop. So coming in closer to where they last were. Maybe they had success overnight and they've got some meat somewhere around here. So then I'm not only listening for the lion's roar, I'm listening for the lion's growl as they argue over a carcass. So whenever you see me pop my head over the side, it means I'm looking for the footprints of those big cats. Have a look in here now. Ooh, is that a track? Is that a track? No, it is not a track. Okay, so we're about 2 minutes away from the waterhole in front of Gallagher Lodge. And I'm pretty certain from where they were last night, it's the spot where they would have gone for a drink before getting moving. And who knows, they might have got lucky and caught something close to it. But don't smell any death just yet. And if you have just found us and you're wondering what the heck is going on, we're on a live African safari. So if you want to ask me a question about what I'm doing, how my tracking's going, a bit more about our dominant pride of lions, please feel free, and you can do that with the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So we're coming up to the waterhole now, and I'm still not seeing any tracks. Maybe these lions were sidetracked by a buffalo and went the opposite direction. So here's the little waterhole. Nothing here, but it's always good to just stop and listen again. If we have a look through the bush here, you can see how the early morning dawn is starting to just come out on the top of the trees. We're still sitting in the shade. It is going to be an absolutely gorgeous morning. I mean, look at that light. Okay, well, let's get moving. Shan's son is wondering, or he's saying, we've seen sticks in Kahuma and Tsalala. How do we separate these prides, and are there more prides? Well, there are definitely more prides, but those are the three of the four prides we see sort of regularly. Now, if we want to say our two most common prides are going to be the Nkuhumas and the Sticks. Now, the Tsalalas, depending on male lion movement, and there's been quite a lot of that recently, they come up from the Sand River from the south, so we don't see them nearly as often as we see the Nkuhumas or the Sticks. Now, there's also to the north of us, there's two prides. There's the Torchwood Pride, the Talamati Pride, who we don't really see, but it is possible that they might meander down towards us. And I know there's another pride that comes in from the south on Cheetah Plains. I'm not sure of their name, but we've seen them at long distance once. And there's also some other males down there. But from the lions we normally see and how to identify them, well, the Nkuhuma lionesses, there's generally five of them. And the Sticks, there are three. And the Tsalala, if I remember correctly, are four. Tsalala, if they're all together, is one of the easier ones to identify because the oldest lioness there doesn't have a tail. So that makes her a bit easy to identify. The Nkuhumas, well, it's also where you find them. And quite often, you're not going to really find Tsalala in the middle of Juma, but you might find the Nkuhumas or the Sticks. Now, lion boundaries of their territories are not set lines. They sort of move, and certain prides will push in, and then they'll go away, and the other pride will push back. So it's quite interesting. And those boundaries are demarcated by mostly by roaring rather than scent marking. And it's just to let all the other lions know that this is their territory. But it looks like these Nkuhuma girls have flown, because I've literally now done a loop. I'm almost back where they were on the sunset safari last night, and I still have not seen one lion track. So I wonder, it might be worth Steph coming into this area and trying to see what he can find on foot and see if he can find those tracks. And speaking of Steph, let's see how goes it on Shank's pony.
Now, after having watched that brilliant sunrise just a few minutes ago, myself and VM have managed to find you a bit of captured sunlight over here. Have a look at this beautiful wasp. It's not often that we get to show you wasps, because wasps fly around in the day and are very active little flyers. They're incredibly busy mothers. This wasp has just spent a chilly evening on top of this Waltheria flower. But have a look at her brilliant colors. Don't you find she's absolutely fantastic? Now, under normal circumstances, I wouldn't get anywhere close to these wasps. They've got an unbelievably nasty sting. And I have these very vivid childhood memories of being stung by yellow wasps. So I have a healthy respect for them. But it is affording us the opportunity to have a look at her mouth parts and from there try and deduce whether she's a pottery wasp or whether she's a paper wasp. Now, you can see her mouth parts don't have chewing pieces. They've literally just got two arms, two spiked arms, but two arms nonetheless. And I'm wagering that because of that, she's a pottery wasp. What that means is that she will fly to some mud, collect a ball of clay and mud, and then go and find a suitable bough of a branch, usually underneath some bark or on the overhang of a branch, and build these most unbelievable pottery jars. Into that pottery jar, she would then place a caterpillar. And on that caterpillar, she's going to lay an egg. Now, wasps themselves, this little lady here, she is a nectivore. She feeds on nectar. But their larvae, their pupa, their babies, are carnivorous. They eat meat. Now, that little worm inside that pottery jar has the wasp's egg on it. That egg then hatches and starts to feed on the caterpillar. Now, the caterpillar is not dead at this point. She has just paralyzed it.
She stung it in a very specific place, paralyzed the caterpillar. The larvae of the wasp goes and eats the caterpillar, starting at all the non-essentials first. Can you imagine? All the muscles, all the soft tissue. And eventually what that caterpillar does, or that pupa does, is then eat the whole caterpillar. It will then pupate and come out as a wasp, and then go out in search of its own mud wallows and caterpillars. Isn't that fascinating? Once again, just displaying those very vivid black and yellow colorings. It's a very clear marking. Leave me alone, I'm dangerous. Wasps will further exacerbate that by having a very loud buzzing noise. They can buzz a warning at you as well. Now, wasps belong to an insect order called Hymenoptera. Hymenoptera include bees and wasps and ants. And ants are the top carnivores in forests. I would wager that ants are probably one of the top carnivores on the planet, because they belong to what's called superorganisms. Wasps and bees and ants can form super colonies where each individual makes up a portion of the colony, but the individuality is almost lost in that particular instance. The organism that is the super colony acts as a whole. And in forest environments, you get the leafcutter ant, you get Matabele ant, so there's a couple of other ants across the world that form these super colonies. Together, they make up much more biomass in an area, for carnivores at least anyway, weighing many times that of a lion or many times that of a jaguar in forests. Lovely, eh? Massive eyes. So, Anna Marie, you're 100% right by saying that this wasp looks like it's too cold to sting, and it absolutely is. They also get their metabolic energy from the heat of the environment, and we are seeing that it's a pretty chilly morning where we're standing at the moment. She spent a night on this exposed leaf, and she unfortunately will have to wait for the sun to come and warm her up before she can fly. And they can vibrate their wings and generate some metabolic heat, but generally speaking, they get all their energy from the food they eat and the environment that dictates the rate of their metabolism. They're cold-blooded insects. Awesome, hey? I mean, I must say, this is probably one of the first times that we've ever seen one of these wasps inactive. Very nice. All right, VM, let's carry on going. All right, and from this wasp to the tent with James, who's got a bug to show you of some sort.
Now, we don't know exactly what this is, everybody, but that picture that Brian has created is absolutely spectacular. It's a little fly of some sort, and that means that it's the same order as the wasp that Steph was looking at. So they're part of the Hymenopterids, and the Hymenopterids are flies and wasps and ants. Those are the most sort of recognizable ones. But this chap is very, very small indeed. He's probably only about, well, how big is he, Brian? He's about 3 millimeters across, I guess. Tiny little fellow. And he's sitting on this piece of grass and unable to move because he's so cold, in much the same way that that wasp was unable to move sitting on the Waltheria flower that Steph had. And they just get very cold. And once it does warm up, he'll fly away. I don't know what he eats. I'm still trying to identify exactly who he is. But there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different species of wasps and flies and ants. And so to get a comprehensive field guide to figure out what they all are is almost impossible. And you know, there are so many of them that you'll find most of them haven't actually been described by science at all. So whether or not this chap actually has a name or not is not clear. And I don't know what he eats, but there was another one sitting on a Waltheria flower exactly the same as the one that Steph was showing you just now. Just look at you move. He's come into the light there, Brian. He wants to be in the stage. I can see. Tiny little feelers. Sensing things in the air. I just think that's magnificent. And those enormous compound eyes that help him to form a rudimentary image of the world around him, but completely dependent on the outside temperature. And that's why you'll find he's crawling towards the light, because something inside him, it will not be a conscious movement, but something inside him will tell him that he needs to be closer to the light to get warm, and then he'll be able to fly off and find something to eat, or perhaps have a mate. Now, when we did this tent thing during the course of the Big Cat Week, which was of course in summer, what we had was a situation where on quarantine clearings here, there were insects abounding. There were flowers popping up everywhere. There were new grasses with different bits of different seeds on them, and every little grass had something that used it for food or was mating on it or breeding on it or something like that. But now the season has changed, and so there's very little around here. And what you can see is that the vegetation has almost disappeared. And that is, look, there's a little bit to do with the drought there. But what it means is that every little piece that there is left, so those Waltheria flowers are seemingly the last flowers that there are, will have something eating them. And that's why Steph is managing to find, well, I mean, he has an incredible eye. But that's why, basically, you walk from Waltheria flower to Waltheria flower and you will find something absolutely unbelievable to have a look at. Here's one of the last flowers as well, and this is our kind of tent decoration or tent garden out here, and this is the last sort of yellowness of the monkey pod, Senna petesiana, and you can just see the last wilting sort of yellow yellow flower, but something will come and eat that over the course of the next little while. So while we have the tent up here for the next week or so, we'll come and investigate to see what has come to eat these flowers. Right, let's go back inside. And while we do that, let's go to Brent and get an update from him and find out how his tracking's going.
So I think those lions are somewhere around camp, so I'm going to leave them for Steph to follow up on, because he can walk into those little drainage systems where we can't get a car. So I decided to come look for the queen of Juma, Karula, our dominant female leopard. This is the area we've been seeing her in most regularly. So I'm just doing a little meander, looking for some tracks. And I can hear some elephants down towards the treehouse waterhole, so hopefully they're there digging up that little seep line, and it'd be quite nice to see them working on their waterhole. Human beings not the only ones who can build a waterhole. The Ellie's out here can do it as well. No tracks so far. But it is an absolutely spectacular morning, and couldn't imagine anything better. I'm just going to be on the Game Drive channel for a second, standing by Abel. So we are in contact with all the other vehicles around us, and we keep in contact to see and help each other find animals. Good, thanks, M4. How can I help? Very exciting news. Copy, thanks. I'll make my way towards the east and have a look there. So last night on the way home, they saw wild dogs. And if anyone who's been watching a long time knows me, I start shivering at the thought of wild dogs, my most favorite animal in the world. And I get to drive fast as well. Get to go on Ferrari safaris. And we're going to slowly move down there. With wild dogs, they move such vast distances that it's a bit of a gamble. So we'll finish checking for Karula first, before we dash down to the east. Lots of elephant tracks, and this is near where I thought I heard those ellies, somewhere down in the little river system that goes into the treehouse waterhole. That those lions made a kill last night. And Mitch in New York is saying, well, how long does it take for an odor to exude during the winter months that we can actually smell and find the carcass? And also, how long does it take in summer? Well, in winter, it can take a day or two, even three, because it is quite cool. How we normally find the carcasses is either from the sound. So you'll hear the lions growling at each other or hyenas excitedly giggling around the carcass. Or we actually track them on foot. It's very, very seldom that we actually find a carcass by smell. In summer, it's much quicker. I mean, if it's a really hot day, over 100 degrees, that thing will be ponging in a couple of hours. But in winter, it can take a couple of days to get a really nice pong about. Elephant tracks everywhere. And we've been having some amazing elephant sightings in this area. Okay, this is of course also the area where we last saw Karula, the female leopard, and her two bundles of joy. Okay, so we're about to come out at the treehouse waterhole. Lots of elephant tracks heading there, but they could have been from during the night. I'm not seeing any elephants at the moment. Okay, here we go. Looks like those ellies must have been here overnight. Have a quick look at the waterhole. If there's nothing there, we're going to slowly meander down towards the Mawati River and see what's happening that side. So unfortunately, nothing happening here, but it's always important to just switch off and listen for a second. What is that? What is that? So I'm just going to ask Gerard to swing his camera. Okay, zoom. A little bit up. A little bit to the left. And go zoom a little bit to the right. And go up a little bit. And the top of that tree. This looks like, is it just a funny shape? It's a funny shaped branch. A little bit to the right there. I thought it might be a big bird of prey at that distance. But it's just, it's actually looks like it is mistletoe. So it's a parasitic plant. And you can see the different color of the leaves. So that plant, like mistletoe you get at home, actually feeds off the other plant, making it produce a hormone called globulin. That pumps more nutrients into that area. I was very convinced it might be a large bird, but unfortunately not. So, treehouse waterhole is not. Oh wait, hang on. No, my eyes playing tricks on me again. While we continue to check the south of the property, let's go see how Steph's doing on foot.
It's a good idea that you're giving Brent some space to go and find whatever he's looking for. That man absolutely excels at being given a task like finding Karula or finding these lions. It's something that Brent is very, very good at. Me personally, I enjoy exploring these little groves, and that's what you've come to us in, is exploring this little grove around this, or this little thicket around this particular termite mound that VM walked you down. Now, quite a big termite mound. But have a look at what I found over here. This is one of the biggest dung beetles that we get here. Oh, we've got some elephant not too far away from here, busy shouting as loud as they can. He's died, obviously. He's not alive anymore, but it gives us a unique opportunity to study these little guys. Here you can see, these are the legs that he pushes his dung ball with. And those spikes there, they dig into the ground and obviously give him purchase for these enormous leg muscles. Now, in terms of insect-wise, these guys can pull several hundred times, I think it's even several thousand times their own body weight. And have a look at that. It's one of the most compact muscle systems in the animal kingdom is the muscle system of these giant beetles. So these four legs here, he's missing two of his back legs. These four legs here are used to push the dung ball. These are to roll the dung ball, excuse me. These are to push the dung and to build the ball. That's why they're shaped like paddles. The reason for that is because he needs to pat the dung ball down into a ball so that he can roll it. Here's what's called a telecoprid. Now, telecoprids roll a dung ball at a dung pile and roll it away and then go and bury it somewhere. And they do that because dung piles are in really, really good treasure troves of different larvae and lots of animals. Particular meerkats and honey badgers and mongoose will come and dig through dung and eat all these guys' babies. So these guys have realized, hang on, wait, let's take our dung ball away and bury it somewhere else, and that way our babies stand a better chance of surviving. So that's why he has these big paddles to paddle the dung into a ball, and then he basically sits like this. If my hand was a dung ball, like this, and he'll then roll the ball away using his hand. And then buries it using this spade. Have a look at that. That is the front part of this dung beetle's face. And that spade is what he uses to bury the dung ball. Isn't that amazing? And these are very, very sophisticated chemical receptors. They can smell dung from hundreds of meters away. They pick up dung particles on the air on those exposed surfaces there, and then smell dung from 100 meters away, and then that allows them to fly and get to the dung ball. Now, they do have eyes. They have eyes that can orientate by the sun there and there. And similarly, so that he can see where he's going with his dung ball, he has those eyes coming out the bottom there and there. Amazing, eh? No external parasites, no nothing else, just this wonderful dung-moving machine, without which we would be covered in flies and covered in dung up to our necks probably. Wouldn't know what to do. These are the fertilizers. Them play a very, very important role in the ecosystem, Acha. Without dung beetles, we would have a big problem. Come with you. Blue butter frog, what an interesting name. It's just asked if dung beetles prefer any particular type of dung or if it's just more common. These ones will go to almost any type of dung from a large animal. They're big and that allows them to process large amounts of dung very, very quickly, and that's what they do. So rhino, elephant, zebra, warthog, that's this one. Big dung beetles for big piles of dung. Then you get the smaller dung beetles. They can specialize in smaller dungs, but you also find them on middens and on big elephant dung. I'd say the smaller they are, the more generalist they are. And then you find dung beetles that only work on carnivore dung. So this is not one, this is a herbivore dung, but you do find dung beetles here, scarabs, that are specialist on carnivore dung. So yes, to your question, they generally are generalists, but you do find in every niche, you find a dung beetle that specializes in a particular type of dung. As I put my rifle down here, I noticed something quite spectacular. On the branch where I put my rifle down is a stick that doesn't look, and I'm going to point it out to you, Viam, on that horizontal branch there, is a stick that doesn't look quite normal. And when I came really close, I realized that it isn't a stick at all. That in actual fact, it's a worm that is trying its best to be a stick.
Have a look at that. Now that's where that worm spent its evening. Obviously trying to stay as hidden as possible by acting like a stick. And I must say, it is remarkably similar in coloration to that branch. Don't you think? Not moving an absolute muscle, not making a twitch. Now that is the forte of these insects. Obviously that caterpillar would be a very juicy morsel. That wasp, for instance, that we were looking at a little bit earlier, this caterpillar is exactly what that wasp would be looking for, to lay her egg on. So he needs to stay, or she needs to stay, absolutely as camouflaged as what she can. And by acting like a stick like that, by coloring themselves with those very cryptic colorations, they do that. And I must say, if it wasn't for me actually putting my face right in there, you know, put my rifle down on that stick, I would never have noticed that bizarre stick position and then found that caterpillar. Obviously, when you're an insect flying around, you don't have, I suppose I can't really say that, hey, it's not that they don't have spatial recognition, but in any case, amazing. I'm sure Brent, racing around the property looking for tracks, is dying to tell you what he's got an update for. We'll see you in a bit.
So we left the area from where we were looking for Krula. I've just got an update that she's got an impala kill to the south of our boundary. They haven't seen the cubs, but I'm pretty sure they're around. So let's leave that area. I'm going to go search for the wild dogs. And then another update. Nkanyeni is in Torchwood. Both cubs are there. Unfortunately, again, outside of our traverse zone. So the only thing left to look for is, of course, my favorite animal, the African wild dog or painted wolf. Lycanpictus. Their tracks were seen just to the east of us here, so we're going to get onto our eastern boundary and cruise down there, see if we can see any tracks. I'm hoping to find an animal soon. It's been quite quiet this morning. But a quiet morning in the bush is better than any morning in the city. And to quote one of my favorite authors, Ernest Hemingway, I never had a bad day when I was in Africa. Now, this is the first question I've ever had from a country I actually lived in for 3 years. So a huge Safari Live welcome to Karen, who's in Tanzania. Habari gani, Karen? There we go. Get to use a bit of Swahili this morning. Karen is asking about lion noises and calls and what do they mean. So of course, lions have quite a lot of different vocalizations, and most of them mean, from my understanding, and of course I don't pretend to be proficient in lion, but the most normal call that you will hear while out in the bush, and you hear it at a big distance, is this is my land. Now that's how it is explained to me as a small child by my grandfather and father, and when I asked what's the lion saying, and they replied, when a male lion is calling, he's saying, whose land is it? Whose land is it? It's mine. It's mine. It's mine. So, now that can be converted also to lioness. So a lot of the loud calling you hear is a declaration of territory. Now, it also is, you could also say, where are you? Where are you? Where are you? Where? 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 So So also there is a form of contact, keeping in communication with other members of the coalition or the pride. And then a lot of the softer calls are also sort of, where are you? I'm trying to think how to put this into a word, but it sounds like, so, maybe, hello, hello. And it's quite soft, and that's generally when the animals are in close proximity to each other. And then they answer, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here. So a lot of that will be communication, declaring, telling all the lions that are outside their pride that this is their territory and they shouldn't come in. And the other is sort of communication, where are you? I'm over here. Oh, come over here. No, 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 you come over here. I'm guessing, of course, because I can't speak lion, but just from watching their behavior. Now, when lions hunt, the communication is very different. Obviously, it's silent. And there's a really fascinating study going on at the moment about visual communication in lions. So the movement of the tail, ears, etc. And after watching lions for many years, I truly believe that there's so many visual signals that we possibly can't even see that happens between these cats. And you watch how they watch each other when they stalk, and one lioness goes that way, and then all of a sudden she moves a little bit and the other changes her direction. And I think there's quite a lot that we still don't understand about a lot of the creatures. And that's the wonderful thing about being out here. We learn constantly. We get to see such fascinating behavior. And of course, half the fun is trying to interpret what it means. And finally, we have a creature with a heartbeat up ahead. It is unfortunately not a lion, Karen. And it is something occasionally lions like to eat, as well as most of the other predators out here. There we go, we've got some impala. Quite a beautiful antelope. And, oh, sorry, let me have a look at those tracks. Yeah. No wild dog track yet. Oh, this is going to be very, very pretty. And we've got them in the back light over there. Look at that. Isn't that just gorgeous? Hello, impararas. You can see the spider webs. You can see the little, what we call michis, which are tiny little insects buzzing around. You see the young boys growing up fast. Now, in Afrikaans, impala of that age are called penkops, which basically translates to pen head, because their horns look very similar to pens. Oh, got an itchy spot there. Now, just as the big predators and the buffalo and whatnot are plagued by biting flies, so are they. And then you see the very important is you can see those. Here we go, he's having a scratch, but look just over his back and look at the bum of the one that's facing us there. Now we can see the different colorations on there, and you can see those very distinct three black stripes. Now those are very, very important. So a lot of the biting insects, ticks, flies, are attracted to darkness. So those black stripes are meant to keep, or try keep, the biting insects and arachnids away from their soft nether regions. Of course, it doesn't work always, but it does help to alleviate some of the parasite load from the areas that are a little bit more sensitive. And look at this lovely camera work back here out there. Look at those bugs buzzing around in the early morning light. And see how they're constantly alert. Watch their ears. They're always moving this thing. See, that one heard. Yes, you're a very alert little female. Now, can you believe that's one of this year's babies? Already all grown. Now, probably one of the most numerous antelope, or not probably, it is the most numerous antelope we see on the safari. And sometimes overlooked, but I find them incredibly graceful and beautiful. Now, they can jump in a straight line about 20 feet, and that's one of the ways they evade predators. They are very quick as well. They can probably do around 50, 55 miles an hour, but they can keep it up for over a kilometer. And included with those massive jumps makes them one of the more difficult animals to catch, even though they are most numerous. And being most numerous, the most numerously eaten. An incredibly adaptable antelope that is both grazer and browser. It is the ideal generalist, and that's what makes them so successful. So successful, in fact, that they've remained completely unchanged for 1.6 million years. So their design is so great that it doesn't need any tweaking. And we're going to look for the animal that loves to eat impala the most, the African wild dog. And while we continue to do that, let's go see what Commander Bond is up to in the tent.
I have two quite interesting things here. Oof. That was Brian approaching me very quickly. I have two quite interesting things here. They are from the black monkey orange, and they are the same plant, believe it or not. One, grown in Natal, where the soils are red and rich in iron and various other nutrients. So that's about what, Brian? About, well, you can see the book in the background there. It's probably about 4 inches across. And then the same tree found in the Lowveld, where the soils are much more ancient, much more weathered, and granite-derived, so very little iron in them and very little in the way of decent mineral. And that's the same plant, believe it or not. One can fit neatly into the other. Now, they are interesting because they're quite good to eat. Obviously, eating this one is going to leave you a lot hungrier than eating this one. But the pulp is very delicious if it's ripe. And it can be dried and then mixed with honey, or stored and kept, and then mixed with honey, sort of reconstituted with water, if you like, as a sort of powdered and instant meal, if that's what you like to do. But the interesting thing about them is that they're called Strychnos madagascarensis, and all of the Strychnos species are named so for the strychnine that occurs in the seeds. Now, the seeds of these particular ones are sometimes used by people to try and cure snake bite. Now, it's believed that a mamba or cobra bite might in fact be survivable without traditional medicine using the seeds of this tree. Now, they contain strychnine, and what strychnine does, they're alkaloids that start to stimulate the nervous system, and if you have too much of them, you can start, you'll eventually die. Your kidneys and liver will go into failure, and you'll die. But the amount that is in these seeds is possibly just sufficient to stimulate the nervous system. Now, if you are bitten by a mamba or a cobra, remember, they have a neurotoxic venom, which means that your neuro system is going to go into some kind of failure at some stage. Now, whether it's enough to stimulate the nervous system enough to create a response or an ability to get over a mamba bite, I'm not sure. But I imagine a mild cobra bite might be survivable through eating strychnos. Now, that was not traditionally realized. Certainly out here, traditional understanding of neuroscience was very poor. But what it does do is it induces vomiting. And so it was assumed that that vomiting was getting the poison out of the body and therefore helping people survive. And when in actual fact, it was the alkaloids in the toxic strychnine that was stimulating the nervous system and perhaps helping the body to just, you know, eventually your body will work out a neurotoxin as long as you can stay alive for long enough. And maybe the strychnine was just stimulating the nervous system to stay going enough for the body to work the poison out. And I think that's rather fascinating, don't you, Brian?
I do indeed.
Are you amazed?
I am amazed.
You are so amazed, I can tell that. Now, while we answer Joey's question, let's pop outside. Oh, Joey, while we come outside, I'll just give you an idea. Well, I mean, of course, you know what the weather's like. You've been driving around with Brent, so I don't really need to tell you that, but I do need to stand in the sun because it's very cold. Joey, you want to know about whether an animal can be poisonous and venomous. I suppose it could, in theory. Venomous, of course, the difference being venomous is something that can envenomate, in other words, like a snake which will bite you, and then you will become envenomated and either get a swelling or die, and neither of which are very much fun at all. But a snake is not poisonous. You can eat a snake. And so something poisonous is something that you can't eat. So I imagine there are probably a number of insects and bugs which might be able to envenomate but would also be poisonous to eat. Interestingly, if you try and eat a snake, if you eat a snake's venom, as long as you don't have any lesions down your esophagus or in your mouth, which is almost impossible because there's always a little cut or something in your mouth, if you don't have any lesions though, your body, once the toxins hit your stomach, your body will very quickly digest them and they won't have any effect on you. It's when they get into your blood and lymphatic systems that snake venoms have a real issue. So I imagine there are some invertebrates that are both venomous and poisonous, but I don't think you'll find that there are many mammals or reptiles that are venomous and poisonous. Okay, we're going to just warm our faces in the sun, and because we're not moving around too much, but somebody who is moving around too much, of course, Stefan van de Boer with Wim Doornbraak.
Isn't this most amazing when you get the water, the rain that is powered down on top of this termite mound and has exposed all the tunnels that lay just underneath the surface? That's exactly what you're looking at now. You're looking at the exposed tunnels or the exploration tunnels of the top of a Macrotermes natalensis mound. And the reason they're exposed is because of rain. It rained really hard and the termites haven't managed to come and repair those holes yet. And in that is a very interesting discussion because there's nobody that really knows where the termite mounds or termite mounds like this or termite colonies go through an evolution. In other words, a colony expands and then dies and then a new colony colonizes the mound, or whether there's a hereditary passing down of one to another to another. And in other words, the colony stays the same, genetically the same, from one generation to the next over hundreds of years. Some of these termite mounds are older than the trees that grow on them, and some of these trees have been carbon dated at 800 years, 600 years. Me, I don't quite know what to believe. A termite colony like this, or a termite mound like this, quite obviously has no maintenance done on it. And so it's quite obvious that the termites are either otherwise occupied, or this termite mound is dead and either has a small colony inside it or doesn't. This for me just shows that this particular colony has gone through a shrinkage and is busy doing something else with a limited amount of workers, and that's why there's been no maintenance. But this isn't why we really stopped here. I want to come and show you this. Inside this hole, we have a unique opportunity to show you what tortoises do when winter comes along. Have a look inside there. That is exactly where you could expect to find a tortoise in its winter burrow. Now, that tortoise won't come out of that burrow until the days start to lengthen and it starts to get a bit warmer. And that'll only happen in around about September, October. This tortoise has hopefully eaten enough vegetation and collected enough moisture to last it through a very dry season. Now, they are reptiles. They can lower their metabolic rate, and it's what cold-blooded animals do best, is cope with extended periods of low nutrition. And that's what this tortoise has gone and done. Realize that there's not much green vegetation around in winter. Rather than expend energy walking from bush to bush to bush, not finding much to eat, it's decided to go through a dormancy period and go and hide out in this termite mound. Now, for those of you who watch the show and have been watching it seasonally, you'd notice in summer we see lots of tortoises, but in winter we don't see any. But it's very rare that we find you a tortoise in its burrow. And this is one of these opportunities that we've got. That is a hinged tortoise in its burrow, made in a natural cavity in this disused termite mound. Now, we don't quite know if this tortoise dug that burrow or if this tortoise found a cavity and then just excavated it. I'm more inclined to believe that it probably found this cavity and then excavated it. Amazing, hey? Very, very happy that we got to show you that. All right, now we're coming to the power lines where we are at the moment.
And while we were waiting for you to come and see our tortoise, we did see or hear some buffalo. Or hear and see, not hear or see, I should say. I just got their tails swinging when I was standing on top of the Tsumaman before you came to us. And I just got the lazy swish swish of some buffalo. Now, as you can see, the bush around us, fairly thick and at buffalo height. So that band of green that you're seeing on either end of the road is exactly at buffalo chest height. And with the wind blowing quite hard today, it's gusty today, making all the leaves move at the same time and then blocking out the bodies of these buffalo at buffalo height, to now go and look for buffalo and that sort of thing, for me, is a big no-no. So that's one of the things that we're going to do to try and keep safe out here, is to realize when it's good to look for buffalo and when it's not good to look for buffalo. And right now, with this thicket, not a good idea to go and look for those buffalo. So we're going to find our way around this thicket quite carefully, and we obviously can't do it while we're speaking to you, so we're going to send you over to Brent, who I'm sure is dying with an update.
We're in the sort of northeastern corner, and I always have to sort of meander through here at least once a day to look for any tracks of that male leopard, who is my favorite because he's the hardest to find, and his name is Gajima. He's between 5 and 7 years old, so he's started to develop territory, but he's generally further to the north of us. And of course, at this time of the year, water is really important, even more so this year with the drought. So I think we're going to do a little gander down towards the Biffles Hook waterhole, see what's out and about in that area. These Nkuma lionesses have really confused me, because there's just no tracks of them anywhere. Hopefully Steph has some luck on foot. Now, of course, it's not only about the big hairies and scaries. We also do quite a lot of birding, and some of our viewers have got over 200 species on their bird lists for the live drives. And speaking of birds, Siberia, one of our zoomies, not sure what a zoomie is. A zoomie is someone who operates the dam cameras kindly for us. So when you get a fantastic sighting of a leopard on the dam cam, and it's zoomed in beautifully framing the leopard, that is one of the zoomies at work. And Siberia happens to be one of those. Siberia is asking about crow species. When was the last time I saw a crow species in the Sabi Sands? I'd say probably not that long ago, actually. I saw one when I was driving out towards the gate, a pied crow, which is an indigenous crow species. Generally, there are more of them on the high veld and the grasslands, and in South Africa you tend to see them along our major highways, as they are expert at eating roadkill. But not too common here, but you do get them passing by from time to time. Closer to the mountains, we do see them a little bit more often, but again, not something, I don't know if we've ever even showed one on a live drive. You sometimes find them at carcasses competing with the vultures and storks and things, but I haven't seen one on the live drive. I will keep my eyes to the sky for you, Siberia. I'm sure a crow would go well with a lot of people's bird lists. I do love this time of the year. So, Karin, another question from Karin in Tanzania. Karin, are you by chance in the wildlife industry? It sounds like your questions, you might be a tour operator. So, Karin is asking me, how would I describe it? This area I'm in here in comparison to the Serengeti. well, very, very different. We're a lot more dry. So I think if I had to compare the closest in Tanzania to this, there isn't really, maybe Katavi could be a little bit similar. But again, so in Tanzania, your main broadleaf woodland is Miombo or Brachystegia. And our main broadleaf woodland here is Combretum. So it's more arid than the Serengeti. The Serengeti gets two rainy seasons a year. We only have one. Whereas the Serengeti probably gets over 1,000 millimeters on average a year. We average around 400. So very, very different. And the Serengeti is made up of massive grass plains. The soil type is very different there as well. It's quite a lot of heavy clay soils, quite often incorrectly referred to as black cotton soils. There are black cotton soils, but it's not the majority. Here, we're mostly on quartzite or sandy soils that is made up of the breakdown of granite. And there's quite a lot of granite and quartz underneath us. From a safari experience, it's very, very different. Of course, it's a little bit harder to find the animals here because it's a lot thicker, as you can see around us, and not as much water. The Serengeti obviously has that wonderful migration, the second largest mammal migration in large mammal migration in Africa. So they are busy repairing the Buffalo's Hook dam wall, so there's going to be nothing there while the largest cat in the Sabi Sands is operational. And when I say cat, I refer to a bulldozer. So we're not going to go there. We'll keep on. Sorry about that, Karin. I'll back to you in a second. So, oh, it's got to stop the sow habit. It's getting really bad now that I know about it. I think I'm going to have to get a car to stick to hit me every time I say it. I start a sentence with sow. I think I inherited it from Jamie because she used to do it a lot. I nearly did it again. But referring, again, comparing the Serengeti and the Sabi Sands, it's really chalk and cheese. It's a very, very different type of ecosystem. And not to say one's better than the other. They are truly, truly unique systems apart from each other. And the biggest difference, the Serengeti is quite seasonal, specifically when you refer to the migration and a lot of the predator interactions. Here we don't have any big migrations. We have sort of seasonal movements rather than migrations. The animals don't move nearly as big a distance. So now that we are in our dry season, and it's also a very dry year, it's a drought year. As it gets dry and drier, we're going to notice an influx of zebra. But again, they're not coming from hundreds of kilometers away. They're coming from between 50 and 100 kilometers away. We've already noticed a massive influx of elephants into the area. So from a predator point of view, it's a far more stable setting. Our predators don't move as much as they do in the Serengeti. So quite often you will see a lot more different species in a far shorter area. Having said that, the Serengeti, of course, is a wildlife spectacle, and it is definitely something everyone should go and look at once in their life. I've been very lucky. I've been there quite a few times, but it's a very interesting question, and I think I might come back to it a little bit later, Karin. I'm just going to have a quick think about how I want to word this, and while I think about how I want to word this, let's go to the man who always has all the right words all the time, James Hendry.
Words fail me, everybody. There are some impala wandering down towards the Juma Dam, which very neatly brings us to the topic. Question asked by Walking in the Rain, which I don't think is the name given to this person by her mother. I'm assuming a her, maybe a he. Very nice Twitter handle, though. And you want to know where we are in relation to everything, so I thought I would draw you a brief map. As always, before I start to draw, a disclaimer. I am the world's most appalling artist. I have no sense of proportion at all, so I'm going to do it the best way I can. Now, what we're going to do is I'm also going to try and draw it upside down. So basically, this road here, that line, if you like, is the Gowri, not the Gowri main road, the Triple M break. So we've got Arethusa this side and Juma this side. This is south, okay, and we've got the gate over here. And then this over here, the sort of border, am I going the right way here? Yes, I am. That's the border with Biffle's Hook to the north. There's the Cheetah Cut line down there. And I'll explain what all of this means because you might be a new viewer. And there is where Brent was earlier this morning looking for Karula. That's the Gowri main road there. Okay, so that's south, north over here. And this is east. And this is west, obviously. Not so. Right. And you may have heard Brent talk about Simbambili, which is over there like that. And Arethusa, which is over there like that. That's Arethusa, Simbambili. And here's Juma, where we are focused. Cheetah Plains is all far to the east. Now, where we are sitting now is basically over here. Well, it's quite conveniently, there's a little plant growing where we are sitting now. That's all the hub where we are. The final control is around there. We are not far from the final control. We're just sort of to the north of the final control over there, if you like. And the Gowri Dam, or the waterhole cam, is down a little road in front of the camp over there, where those impala are going. They're wandering down that little road over there like that. And then Vuya Taylor camp is over there. And Galago camp is over there. And our little home is over there, the DRC or Juma Research Camp. That's basically how it all fits in here. And I'll just quickly draw you where the other maps are, at another, the other dams. There is the Biffle's Hook Dam. That's the orientation of the Biffle's Hook Dam. I know you were with Brent earlier today at the Treehouse Dam. That sits over around about here, Treehouse Dam. And then the Twin Dams sits over here. I suppose I should actually draw them as dams, shouldn't I, Brian? Yes, horrible drawer I am. So those are the three major ones. Well, with the Gowri Dam here, of course. And there's the dam wall, and it goes off in that direction. Now, the other sort of major geological feature of this reserve is the Mulwati drainage line. And it's a dry riverbed that basically runs through the center of the reserve like that. It starts, comes in at Biffle's Hook, goes out into Little Gowri, where Karula is now. And that's where it is, and much of our activity focuses on this dam or one of the tributaries of it. And the Gowri Dam, which I think I drew over here, is fed by a whole lot of drainage lines and systems that go basically through the camp where we are, and then that feeds down into the valley of the Great Mulwati, and that goes out that way. And then there are a few drainage lines actually that even feed out of Biffle's Hook Dam that feed eventually into the Mulwati drainage line. And that's basically the major geological features of Juma Private Game Reserve. What do you think, Brian?
Magnificent.
It is, isn't it? It's a work of art. It's a pity that we couldn't uplift it from here and then sell it for lots of money. Then I just want to show you one more thing. I've shown you the traversing area that we have. This, of course, it's not in proportion because I have no sense of proportion. But this is 1,200 hectares, or about 2,500 acres. Is that correct? 2.4 times 1.2. No, it's about 3,000 acres. 4,000 acres. I'll work it out some other time. And this is Arethusa, which is 600 hectares times 2.4, which takes us to about 1,800 acres. And then, if we come along here, if you join me along the Gowri main road here, we drive along like this, and we go past Chitwa Chitwa over here, and then we go down to Cheetah Plains, okay? And Cheetah Plains extends like that. It's also 600 hectares. There seem to be quite a lot of forests in Cheetah Plains at the moment. And that's Cheetah Plains there. And Cheetah Plains consists of also 600 hectares. So that's the other traversing that we have. Up here is in Coral, and up here you will hear us mention Torchwood quite a lot. That sits like that, and then on top of all of it is Biffle's Hook. So that's basically the northern Sabi sands, and you can see how we fit in our little patch that is Juma. And you can see how centrally and really nicely centrally placed we are. There it is. Now somewhere knocking about here, I think if I saw him walking off in the right direction, I actually have no idea where he is, but I guess that Steph is somewhere around here. So why don't you nip behind VM and have a look, see what Steph has to show you over there.
Now I know what you're looking at over there is just a piece and shard of bone, but in actual fact that's the leftovers of a leopard kill. This is the leftover impala from a Karula kill from a couple of weeks ago. We did manage to see her in the tree here with some cubs, and this is all that's left. We were in the area here and we thought that we'd come and show you, well, we were wanting to investigate what was left of this impala after Karula had finished with it, and that's the only bone that we can find.
Here is the tree that she had it in. It's a marula tree. And that was the bough that the carcass was on. And she was up here, I don't know, it was about 2 or 3 weeks ago. VM's not 100% sure, and I can't actually recall this particular sighting. But while we're standing here, oh, hang on, wait. Look at this. That's what's left. That's what we came to find.
While I'm standing here, I just wanted to get final control to let Brent know that there are vervet monkeys calling like you can't believe the power lines junction with Triple M. We don't have a game drive radio, so it's quite tough for us to keep in touch with them. But power lines junction Triple M, there's monkeys calling. So it could even be Karula actually. But whew, now that I'm standing here, I can actually smell this leftover leg over there. That would make a brilliant meal for a tawny eagle or a battalier eagle. They quite often will feed on carrion like that, but they obviously haven't seen that from the air. But come and have a look at this. This is another quite interesting thing. We obviously have seen leopard carry carcasses up trees before, but it's not until you get really close that you see the marks. Now, what's immediately apparent is some claw marks. Have a look at how deep that is. And all the way up this tree are these marks where Karula dug her claws into this and then scratched and scrabbled her way up here, dragging a carcass that probably weighed around about as much as what she did. Now, to put this into perspective, take a cement bag, clamp it tightly in your teeth, and then using your fingernails, climb up the first tree that you can get to across the road from where you are. That will give you some perspective as to the enormous feat of strength that is a leopard treeing a carcass. They obviously do it because it's necessary to keep their meal safe from marauding hyenas. Hyenas in general steal a lot of carcasses. But this tells quite an interesting story. We even found this piece of bark that had quite obviously come off of this piece of tree. The head fits there. Karula's claw got stuck there and then pulled it off after scraping along the bark, and then pulled it off, and then she re-hooked it there. So that was her scrabbling to get to it. And then there are hairs from the impala that got stuck in the tree bark here. That's some hair from the impala. Isn't that amazing? I just find the stories about these stories that these trees can tell with regards to that. I mean, if you have a look here, we're going to try and see if we can give you a nice perspective of what Karula must have been seeing. From here is basically where that leopard's head would have been. She would have looked up, seen this particular angle, exactly as you're looking now, is the leopard's perspective, exactly. She then would have bounded up the tree, carrying a carcass, and then gone around that knob there onto that bough for a slight reprieve. As you can see, even there,
There's, let me get a stick. Even there, there's a piece of bark from her claw. There is a scrape mark. And there. She then would have had to have gone around that. Now that in itself, I don't even think I could do it. I don't even think James could do it. And James is quite an adept tree climber. And she would have then had to go around that onto the branch to put her kill there. I mean, an absolutely supreme effort. I just think it's fantastic. Quite a nice story, eh? Fingernails, cement bag, jumping. Obviously, my shoes don't have claws and my fingernails are nice and short, so it's not gonna work. And then she finished it. And all that's left is that rotting leg that is feeding beetles and flies at the moment. That's about the only thing that's feeding. Nice, hey? Nice story to hear and to try and picture in your mind. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to carry on wandering off in this direction. Brent is hot on the trail of those monkeys that are calling. We're going to leave him to it. We are going to get over the crest over here again and go and see what else is in this block. Come along. Let's see what we've got here. Oh, now I can smell that leftover leg over there. The wind is wafting it in this particular direction and it's rankling. It definitely can wrinkle the nose a little bit. Ah. And of course, while we behave like unobtrusive things over here and try and weave our way through the bush, it gives James a nice opportunity to show you one of the artifacts that he's got in his collection. See you in a bit.
Now everybody, that is a tortoise shell, obviously, and James, Richard, you were asking about the horn moth and whether the horn moth would eat a tortoise shell, and the answer is absolutely not, and that's simply because they're made of different things. Now, a tortoise shell, if you look carefully, is made largely, I think, of calcium. This was a male tortoise when it met its end. And I'll show you why it's called, it was a male tortoise. You can see it's got a very kind of closed bottom there. And it's also got a concave plastron. The plastron is the bottom side here. Now, it is part almost of the skeleton. Now, can you get the camera in there, Brian? I don't know. Let me just get a light. Stand by, everyone. 1 second. I'm just going to get a light so we can shine it into the middle of the tortoise shell here. And what that will do is we'll just show you that how much a part of the skeleton the tortoise shell actually is. You see that? That's where it connects to the spine, almost through the skin. So it's not like you can remove the tortoise from the shell with a sort of harmlessly and put him into another one. He is inextricably linked to the shell and it's almost part of the skeleton there. You can see there's a nerve channel that goes through there. That's quite cool. Well done, Brian. So that's the tortoise shell, and if we look up here to what James was referring to, he was referring to these moths here that eat away at the keratin sheath of the buffalo skull. So this keratin sheath is, well, it's a sheath made of keratin, unsurprisingly, but it is made specifically of keratin and a specific type of keratin that covers the horns of antelope and buffalo. And if we have a closer look here at what we're looking at, I'll just put it in the light here, Brian. This is the pupa of the larva. Now, a larva, of course, I can actually find you some old chrysalises. So a larva is the caterpillar stage of the moth that eats away at this keratin. And here are the remains of the actual caterpillar itself. You can see there, shining, glistening copper in the sun. And that would have come out of this little pupa made of keratin and dung. and it would have flown away. Now, the real advantage, of course, of being or having this stage, most mammals, in fact all mammals, and just about all vertebrates, have got no metamorphosis that they go through. We're a young version of us, looks pretty much the same as us when we grow bigger. We eat the same sort of things, but for milk. Now, obviously, none of the insects are able to feed the youngsters milk, but what they have done, and the more advanced insects, and by advanced I don't mean kind of better, I just mean that they've evolved later, is that they've evolved what we call a hollow metabolic life cycle. Now, the hollow metabolic life cycle means that they go through these two stages. And what it gives us is this chance for the youngsters or the immature individuals to eat something completely different from the adults, which means that one species can take advantage of two different food niches, if you like, without having to worry about it. So while they're in the vulnerable stages, the caterpillars eat in the safety of a buffalo horn, and then when they're ready to breed, they fly off and they eat something else. And I think that's really quite clever, because of course we know that most species have evolved trying to separate their niches from each other, their food niches from each other, so that they don't eat the same thing. Now, in these very clever hollow metabolic insects, they don't ever eat the same sort of thing. Let's just have a quick look at one or two other tortoise shells. Now, James Richard, you say that there's an American species of horned moth that feeds exclusively on the on the shell of the gopher tortoise. I don't dispute that, James, but I don't think that the ones here would do the same thing. I suspect that that American species of horned moth has adapted to eating rather more calcified substances than keratin. I'll do a little bit more research into it, but I'm pretty sure, I've certainly never seen one here. They don't eat these tortoise shells. The only thing that eat these tortoise shells are things like porcupines. And porcupines eat them because they can get at the calcium. They like the calcium. And then one or two birds, I'm sure, would have a go. And just look, I mean, this is essentially a bone. And you can see how it has, you can see how the osteocytes here have grown together, and that the individual bones that make up this tortoise shell have joined and then grown apart. And it's much the same way as a skull grows. And if you don't know what I mean, I'll show you. Have a look here. Let's take our old pal, no, not this one. Let's look at the lion. Here's the lion. Now, if we look at the lion here, everybody, what we have, you can see there are a number of different bones. Although this is a skull, it's made up of a number of different bones. And you all know that when a baby human being is born, that the skull is not fused on the top. And nor is it in many of these animals. Here is a line between two bones that leads up onto the sagittal crest. Here is another line between bones. And of course, what this allows for is for the skull to grow. Before these have completely ossified, before these joins, so this is the nasal bone, for example. I think this thing is called the maxilla, if I'm not mistaken. This is known as the zygomatic arch, where my hand is there. And all of these things you can see are joined. And what they're not joined like this, fully formed, when the animal is young, because obviously it would be impossible for something of this complicated shape to grow into a bigger version of its smaller self, unless it had these joins. And it's at these joins that the individual bones of the skull will grow, and so that they can get, you know, so that eventually when it achieves adult size, then you get this fusion together of the different bones of the skull. And the same thing goes for this tortoise. But a tortoise, of course, never die. A tortoise, of course, never stops growing. And say they will never completely fuse these little bones. They all grow slightly at the same time, and probably slightly different times, but it means that the whole shape, this complicated shape, can keep growing without it having to sort of grow as one. It grows as many. Does that make sense, Brian?
It does.
Do you have a vague idea of what I mean there? So it's completely unlike, for example, this bone here, which will grow from two sites. It'll grow from, what is that? Oh no, it's just a bit of muck. So this will grow from two sites. It'll grow from the top here and from the bottom. I think that's how a bone grows. I may need to check that up, but that's basically how it grows. But you can see the shape remains the same. It's not complicated to just add bits and pieces to it from one end or the other. With a complicated shape like a skull, that's obviously not possible. Now, Stefan, after showing you where Karula had her kill, has found himself a bush.
I have indeed found myself a bush, and the reason for finding this bush is that you've come across us in the middle of a discussion, and I'd actually like to extend that discussion to you because it's very interesting. We're talking about different venoms, and scorpion venom versus spider venom versus snake venom, and other things like, suppose, cone shells or box jellyfish, for instance, and how only a little bit of venom can kill a person, and why are we so scared of a thing like a black mamba, for instance, or why are we so scared of a thing like a box jellyfish? But how does it work? How do we actually measure toxicity or measure the virulence of a particular toxin? Now, black mambas have got a fearsome reputation for being nervous snakes and quick to bite, and quite often their bites are lethal. They have enough venom in their fangs or in their poison glands and in an envenomation to kill you. But it, by volume, isn't that toxic. They inject an enormous volume into you, but by volume it's not that toxic. And by that I mean, I think, and please don't quote me on this, I'm just going to use it as a ratio, but 0.02% of black mamba venom is needed in your bloodstream to kill a human being weighing about 150 pounds. Now, we always thought that they were the most deadly, but in actual fact, a vine snake out here, or a boomslang out here, is one of the top 10 snakes, and that needs 0.002% of a milligram in a 70 kilogram human to kill you. So VM was going, but, you know, why is it so dangerous? Why don't we see more people being bitten to death by boomslangs than being bitten to death by mambas? It's quite easy. Mambas are handled more. They're a more exotic snake. They are kept as pets more, and they are more nervous, and they bite people more. Whereas a boomslang, you don't really see them. They don't feature in much. They don't feature in the world's most dangerous snakes, basically. And it's because they're relatively shy, reclusive snakes, and even if handled, they don't readily like to bite. But next to some of the most poisonous, or the most toxic, or most venomous, organisms on the planet, even these snakes with their quite virulent toxin isn't actually that bad. You've got a thing like a box jellyfish, some of the scorpion venoms, some of the spider venoms, are by volume, you only need a much, much smaller amount to kill a human being weighing 70 kilograms. I think a box jellyfish is somewhere in the 0.0 and then 5 or 6 zeros is enough to kill you. Thing like a violin spider, which we saw yesterday on the walk, is a tiny little spider this big, and it has enough venom in its little bite. And I mean, we're talking about fangs that are less than a millimeter big, and probably his whole body isn't. Sorry, I've got these flies buzzing around my head, you know, my eternal nemesis. And VM was quite shocked to say, but how can something so small deliver enough venom to kill a human? But the point I'm trying to make is that it's not about how much venom is injected as much as it is about the virulence of the toxin to kill a human being. And they measure that in milligrams for a human being weighing about 150 pounds, about 70 kilograms. And so that's what you caught us having a discussion about. I hope I've explained it adequately. It feels like I'm mumbling and waffling on about the topic. All right, and then VM says he's found a lone ranger. I don't quite know what that means. Oh. VM's lone ranger is one soldier termite that is wandering on his own far away from any termite colony. Now, having looked around here, I can't see any of his friends, and I'm at an absolute loss as to decide why is this soldier termite on his own. Now, it's not uncommon to find worker termites on their own, but to find a soldier termite on his own is actually quite bizarre. But now, looking at where I'm standing, I can actually see that we are standing on the excavations of a bunch of harvester termites. And I'll show you where I can see the entrance, and I think he's come from here. So there is the entrance of some harvester termites. They've obviously been harvesting around this evening, or last evening, and were probably disturbed, and then on the piece of grass that was carried away by whatever it was that disturbed these termites, this poor soldier was carried away and now has to find his way back to his home before he gets picked up by a bird, and he would make the most unbelievably tasty morsel for an insectivorous bird. VM quite nicely referring to him as the Lone Ranger, probably the bravest termite in his colony at the moment. All right. Samson, yes, we do get ant highways here that lead to ant nests, absolutely. Ants, one of the few things that you can actually track by their highways. You absolutely get highways, but usually the highways are associated with ants moving from one colony to another. They move their colonies from time to time, every couple of days to every couple of weeks, in fact. And when they're moving their whole colony, they leave these trails. Feeding trails by ants are quite often a dispersal. They have a dispersed nature when feeding, and there they drop chemical trails so they can find their way back to the nests. So when they're dispersing, they go along trails, they reach the end of the trail, they do a bit of an exploration search, and then they go back along their trail again, back to their colony. You don't see those leaving highway marks, but generally they leave highway marks when they're moving from one colony to another. And I have seen highway marks when they're moving from a particular bush, now the end of the season, back to their home again, when they're just using one particular bush. Termites, on the other hand, don't leave trails at all. They quite often cover their trails. You can see here, this worker termite came from this. That is, the termites, they came out last night, they then harvested. You can see this is relatively fresh, and then they went back in this morning and have actually covered up the entrance to their hole with some mud. You can see there, see, I can push through, there we go, I've pushed through the opening. It was covered by a cap, but now I can see that you can actually see inside there. But you can see all this mud here that was laid down by the termites last night, harvested termites, and then they retreated at dawn and covered up their termite colonies, just leaving these things. And we're standing on a vast colony. These harvested termites are actually quite incredible. They can harvest up to 3 metric tons per hectare of vegetation. Now, a ton is 1,000 kilograms by 1,000 kilograms. And if I were to say, it's probably about 2,200 pounds by 2,200 pounds by 2,200 pounds would give you the equivalent in North America. So a lot, actually, per hectare over here. But it's given us some time for Brent to come into this area and hopefully has an update for you on whatever those monkeys were calling at. So we're going to send you through to Brent for that.
Lots of updates, and as you can see, I'm in a rush to get somewhere, but I'm not going to tell you where just yet. So that monkeys were alarm calling at Shadow. They lost her in a very thick little river system. We're going to go have a look after we've gone where we're going. Also, I had tracks of what I presume is Tingana heading towards Red Dam, so also a place we're going to go have a look at a little later in the show. But for now, we're on our way to our first big cat of the morning, and we're nearly there, and I'm trying to get there as quickly as possible because they are on the move. Oh, I nearly forgot another update. So four of the five in Kahuma ladies are to the west of us, and with two of the Birmingham boys. So they are not too far away, and it sounds like they're on a kill. I can't hear what, but hopefully nothing too big, so they come back to us. We're on our way to see different lions, and I wonder which lions they could be. They're quite close to one of our traverse boundaries, so that's why I'm rushing, and hold on, I do apologize if we're bouncing around. While we bounce around, let's go see what James is up to in the tent.
Now, this is an amazing animal, everybody, that Brent Leo Smith and his family found when they lived at Pinder. And it's a bivalve of some sort, which is a very primitive animal, but it's a fossil, and it's a rock. Now, I think many people don't really understand what a fossil is, and I certainly, for many years of my life, were under the impression that a fossil was basically a bone, an ancient bone that was found, but it isn't. In fact, it is nothing like a bone. Let's come over here, and I want to show you something interesting. Brian, just let me know if your cable becomes difficult to wrangle. You okay there? Right, so here we have a buffalo skull, and
hang on.
Shall I bring the buffalo?
Let me just free myself from this log.
Ryan is just freeing himself from a log. Here he comes, stout fellow. We would normally, of course, have a cable basher, I think is what they call it. Brian, why don't you have a seat over there if you'd like? Okay, so. Now, what we have here is a buffalo skull, and you would normally imagine that a buffalo skull like this, this bone, you would imagine one day finding it as a fossil. And certainly when you see human fossils, you think of them as being bone, and they're not, they're rock. They're just like this. It feels like a piece of rock, but it has an unusual shape. And why does it have an unusual shape? Well, I shall attempt to explain to you. Just look under here, inside there, you can see that the bone is gone. And the bone has gone even before the keratin has gone. It's been eaten away, in this case, I think, by termites, which is, I think, is quite interesting. And so the bone has it smells like chocolate. Smell that, Brian.
Oh, yeah.
Delicious. Keratin-flavored chocolate. So what happens is when a bone, say this skull, dies, it will normally rot away. And I know that they last a lot longer than the flesh, for example, but the bone will eventually rot away or be eaten by termites or something like that. Now, when a fossil forms, what happens is the bone falls into normally water, normally seawater, and that's why they're so rare. That's why finding a fossil is so unusual, and why most of them are, in fact, marine animals like this giant bivalve, which is a sort of snail-like thing eventually, you know, ancient snail-like thing. And what they do is that the bone falls into the water, onto the surface of the, or onto the, floor, the sea floor, and slowly it sinks down and it gets covered with sediment that falls into the sea. It comes from rivers, it comes from the atmosphere, it comes from all over. And because there's nothing like a termite in the bottom of the sea to eat the bone then eventually gets buried. And all around the bone, because of the increased pressure and the increased sedimentation, that sediment eventually turns to rock. And inside, the bone is preserved. But the bone will eventually kind of dissolve under the action of the seawater, and it will be replaced inside by the minerals in the seawater. So all around you have the sediment, and then in the shape of the bone, or in this case the bivalve, you have a different substance. It's the minerals of the sea that have then created a shape or a mold, if you like, or a cast of what was originally a bone. And that's what a fossil is. Eventually that is exposed to the atmosphere by, say, tectonic activity. So perhaps there's a giant earthquake, or when mountains form, for example, they push the landscape up like that, the sea retracts, and fossils are exposed on the surface. And that, everybody, is how we find fossils. Now, what I find so amazing about that is that the chances of actually becoming a fossil are almost negligible. 99.99% of us, when we shake off this mortal coil or pop our clogs, we'll be buried in the ground and we'll disappear. Within 50 years, we'll be completely gone. Some may, well, for example, sailors or perhaps those who've had to walk the plank will be fossilized in the sea. And millions of years from now, when there's another civilization knocking about the earth, wondering about history, they will be exposed. But can you imagine trying to interpret the life story of something that is a million years old, that probably died in completely unusual circumstances, because for it to have died in normal circumstances, it's highly unlikely it would have made a fossil. So for us to be interpreting human history from fossils takes a huge amount of skill, and it really isn't easy at all. And I think we've probably made hundreds and hundreds of mistakes, because to interpret life and history from these fossils when they are so rare and they are so unusual when they to form, it is so unusual for any organism to form a fossil, I think is quite amazing. Anyway, this bivalve is millions of years old. Millions. That's longer than the human being has been around the earth, and I find that absolutely astonishing. Now, I want to show you one more thing, because I did a little bit of research on the back end of James Richards. I've got a thorn in my bottom, Brian. Oh. It's very uncomfortable.
Oh, sorry, James.
It's okay. Yes, I'm all right. On the back end of James Richards saying that the gopher tortoise is eaten by a keratophagus or moth, horn moth, in the United States. I did a little bit of research, and he is of course correct, but I didn't know about that, so I just did a little checkup. And what we find on these tortoise shells is that these scutes here, indeed, James, are keratin. So that scute is keratin. That is bone. It is straight, plain, calcified bone underneath there. But these scutes, that one species of keratophagous moth in the United States does indeed eat just the keratin. Well, it will also eat cattle horns, but it will eat this keratin here. Now, I don't think the moths of Africa, they don't eat the tortoises, they only eat horns, and that's simply because they're unable to get into the keratin here. They're not adapted to it. It's too thin. They need to get into the fat layers of keratin on the horns. Okay, so that's all I have to tell you about that. Let's head across to Steph. I'll just have a quick look and tell you what he's doing. Ah, he's hiding behind Strychnos madagascarensis.
I'm not trying to hide behind the Strychnos madagascarensis, James. I'm trying to see what is those eggs there. Now, they're obviously from a moth or a butterfly of some sort. And that moth or butterfly thought that she was hiding her eggs on the bottom part of that leaf. And then what happened was the leaf dried up and curled. And in the curling process, exposed the eggs. I'm just trying to figure out whether or not they are hatched or not. They've got a little black center to them. No, I'm looking into the super zoom because, believe it or not, the zoom can actually see closer than what my eye can. And I see that they all are entire. Oh, they've got a little cavity in the middle. I don't know if that's the egg or whether or not it's hatched and the caterpillar's come out. It's actually incredible. Not too sure what it is. Now, judging, I would imagine that if it was a caterpillar of some sort, we would have seen the caterpillars on this branch already, or we would have seen signs of them feeding somewhere. And I don't really. There's not really any sort of massive feeding sign of anything in this particular plant, or of any pieces of silk, or of any caterpillars of any type. It is a good thing to know that something is laying its eggs on this madagascariensis, because to be honest, we need more things out here that eat these guys. Anyway, so some unidentified egg, basically. It's quite nice as you're spending... Ah, here we go. Here's a baby Ozoroa. I love these bushes. Something is definitely eating this. You can see how the leaf
beetle has been eating from the center of the leaf outwards. Now that is typical beetle feeding behavior. Now these ozoroas, they have resin inside of them. And what you do is you scratch the bark of a bigger one and you'll see that it starts to weep. You'll see that it's weeping, might show some weeping. Some milky sap coming out. Now that milky sap you can collect and you can boil over a slow fire, not boil, you just sort of warm over a slow fire, and it turns into this incredibly tacky bird lime. Then what you do is you take that bird lime and you go find yourself a little pool of water somewhere, usually at a seep that elephants have been digging, and you stick a branch in the sand just like this. You stick it into the sand and you anchor it. So if you can imagine, here would be a puddle. Birds would obviously fly and land on the branch and then go and drink at the puddle. By taking bird lime and winding it around this branch and leaving it there, birds that come and land on the bird lime will get stuck in this tacky glue, basically, and you can collect lunch that way. And I learned that trick from that friend of mine, Richard in Dubai, who used to, as a young man, augment the lunch that he used to have as a herd boy by catching birds using bird lime just from a plant, just like this ozoroa that we have growing over here. Whenever I pass one of these trees, it always gives me a bit of a nostalgic pang to remember old Richard and these fantastic stories that he used to tell of all these things that he used to get up to. All right, now we are wandering along the crest of this hill, and I think Brent is fast on his way to try and get into the area where those monkeys were calling, and I know that he has an update for you.
The lions got lost, so I'm going to tell you who they are now, because I was hoping to show them to you, but they've disappeared into the bush here. It was the Salala pride, so I think they might have just gone to sleep somewhere close by to where they were last seen, which is here. So I'm just going to do a little bit of a meander through the block. That's not the right way to go. I hit a bit of a dead end. Let's try a little bit further to the south. So their general direction was sort of south down towards the Arethusa Dam camp. So guys, keep a lookout. And if those lions pop up there for a drink, please let me know. I'll be most appreciative. Okay, let's find a spot to get in. Let's try think. Wow, if we were a lion, where would we go? Now, I'd definitely be heading towards the water, but I'm a lion, so I'm quite lazy as well. And the only thing that's going to distract me from getting to that water is a snooze. So a nice spot of shade. Oh, it's been quite chilly this morning, maybe a little bit of sun. Or if I see something to eat. Now, we did see some impala to that side, so there could be stalking something, but because it's a lion, let me see if I can see a track here, it's most likely gone for a snooze. Lions sleep for about, on average, 20 hours of the day. There's a nice game path, and if I was a lion, I would like to walk down the game path. No tracks here. Just want to listen for a second, see if we can hear any alarm calls. We know there's some impala there, there's some water back, and they're not making any noise. And they're not far off, probably 150 meters or so. Just want to check all the shade quite carefully. So while Gerard and I go on an exploratory run into this large bushy block, let's go see what the others are up to.
Well, we've come out of the tent, everybody, because it's a bit warmer out here in the sun, isn't it, Brian?
It is
much warmer. And, well, I'm going to show you something inside this buffalo skull. It's a different buffalo skull. I think many buffalo died here at some stage of history, or quite possibly they were brought here for Big Cat Week, during which we used them in the tent and then scattered them about the place. So here's another wonderful example of what might happen in history. You can imagine somebody coming across here and finding all these bones and tortoise shells and all sorts of things that have been discarded here. And they might think, well, there was either a great death here, or perhaps a buffalo graveyard, or perhaps a human settlement, and this was their midden, as opposed to, I mean, how many people do you think would come up with the conclusion that this had been some kind of studio place where people had been filming and sending a signal over the internet to show others around the world about the wild? I'll tell you how many. Zero. Now, in here, there is a bit of a spider. Can you see the spider there, Brian? I think it's a spider. I just didn't want to touch it before we came live. You see it there? Oh, it's moved. Hang on, it hasn't moved. It's dead. I can retrieve it for you. Wait, let me retrieve it. I think it's just the spider's exoskeleton. You know what? It isn't a spider. It's one of what you were looking at with Steph earlier this morning. It's an assassin bug. And it's just the exoskeleton of the assassin bug. Now the bugs, remember I was talking about a hollow beastly little thing. Remember I was talking about a hollow metabolic life cycle where an animal goes through the cycle of from larva to pupa and then into the adult. That is called a hetero metabolic life cycle. You don't need to remember it. But the bugs don't go through that larval stage. The youngsters resemble the adults. And what that little piece was one of the instars, is what you call each stage of development. They have to shed that exoskeleton in much the same way that a snake sheds its skin. So these bugs must shed their exoskeletons because, of course, the exoskeleton can't grow. It's unlike a bone inside the body which can grow internally, and so they must crawl out of the hard exoskeleton. A new, larger one will then form around the body. And then they leave those sorts of shells around the place. So this assassin bug climbed into this buffalo and it found a sheltered spot through which to sort of crawl out of its instar stage to the next stage. And of course it's very vulnerable while the exoskeleton is getting hard, and that's why it will find a refuge like this buffalo skull over here. Just want to see what else I can find in here. But while I look, have a look at this that I have in Meand. This is something called Leonotus leonurus, and like most of the flowers around here at this time of the year, it looks like it is dead. That is because it is dead, and it used to have beautiful red sort of flowers coming from all the holes that you can see there. It's quite spiky, and it's interesting nature, of course, or the interesting thing about it, that it's called wild dacha. Now, to many of you overseas, you won't know what dacha is, but dacha is a local term for marijuana. And although the seeds do not have a narcotic effect, it is said, and I've only heard this on hearsay, that the roots of this plant can be crushed up, dried and smoked for a very mild narcotic effect. It must be very mild because the plant is by no means in any way illegal to grow. So I don't know, I've never met anybody who's actually ever tried it, but apparently it has some kind of mild narcotic effect. So that's Leonotus leonurus. A very good word to say in the morning if you are in the tent and you need to warm up your lips. Leonotus leonurus. A bit like saying Benedict Cumberbatch. Mm. Not so.
Exactly.
Yes, exactly like that. Just to warm things up. Right, let's go for a little wander about the place. We obviously can't go too far away from where we are now. We were hoping to get the microscope going today, but it doesn't seem to want to talk to my computer at the moment. But we will sort that out over the course of the next week, and that's why we're knocking about here, hoping to find... we're knocking about here, hoping to sort our iron out those little problems before we go to TV. Let's have one more look at a plant down here. And this, of course, is an acacia tree. And it's an acacia tree called the flaky thorn acacia. And on it, Brian, is something I cannot possibly identify. So I'm not going to... Let's ignore that acacia tree and move to this one over here. This is a flaky thorn. And the flaky thorn is an unusual thorn in that it starts to grow in clearings like this and becomes an encroacher species if you're not careful. And it's quite interesting that during a drought, these trees start to grow up. So I've seen three or four of them around here already. In fact, there are five just where I'm standing. And during a drought like this, when the grasses are denuded by grazing and there's no surface water for them to grow in, these trees with their long tap roots will start to take over. So were the drought to persist, in fact, I've just noticed that there are dozens of them around here now. So you'd probably find were this drought to persist, these acacia trees would eventually form a thicket, and so the vegetation would change. Let's go and have a look at a beetle with Steph.
And a beetle indeed is what we've managed to find you. One of the most voracious ones that we found out here. This is a predatory ground beetle. And predatory ground beetles are very fast-moving beetles that use those massive chompers, those mandibles on the front of his face, to cut up insects that they find wandering around at nighttime. It is a nocturnal beetle species, but that is not what is interesting me most about this particular beetle. These beetles have inside of their bodies a substance called cantharidin. And cantharidin, I grew up knowing as Spanish fly. Now, the Spanish fly is a beetle that is present, and as far as I understand, I would imagine why it's called Spanish fly, would be Europe somewhere, or at least in the Mediterranean, and is a similar beetle to this one. And what you do with this beetle, or what has been done with this beetle, is you collect these beetles, you then grind them up into a powder, and the powder is then introduced as an aphrodisiac in humans. Cantharidin elicits it's actually your body responding to poisoning in actual fact. Cantharidin is a poison for us, but it manifests itself in a tingling, or in small doses at least, in a tingling of mucous membranes. And that is exactly what is supposedly supposed to be the aphrodisiac effect. Myself, I've never used it before, and I refuse point blank to give my wife any of these basically powdered up beetles. But what's quite interesting is I had a chat to a paramedic here the other day, and he reckons that just in this area, about 20 cases per year are admitted to the local hospital with cantharidin poisoning, of amorous men becoming a little bit too heavy-handed with their dosages of cantharidin. Now, they would get cantharidin, or they would get the ground-up beetle parts from the local inyanga, or the local shaman. They would go and petition the local shaman, and with offerings of money and favors, or favors, the inyanga would then give them some of this love potion, and with strict directions to use it. This knowledge is obviously passed down by generation to generation over thousands of years, totally separate, of course, to the traditional medicinal use of Spanish fly in Europe. Of course, there was no connection, no modern connection, at least anyway. And then they would take it home and administer it to the lady the object of their desire, and then hopefully it would have the desired effect. But as you can imagine, sometimes these guys got a little bit too, heavy-handed would be the way to go. And then this beetle would be the cause of their girlfriend not liking them anymore. Nocturnal beetle, ground beetle, we're going to put him back in his stump. Quite a fast-moving beetle, in actual fact. They've got one of the fastest locomotions of the insects out here. Their method of hunting is running into an area and stopping. And then they've got these big eyes on the side of their head, and they just look for movement. And basically anything that moves or got a fright by them running into the area is attacked and then cut up with their mandibles, and then they're eaten up, and then the beetle carries on with its day. Quite a voracious little predator. I'd hate for these beetles to be as big as ponies, I definitely don't think that we'd number 7 billion on the planet if we were. Yeah. So, Sally all the way from Oregon says that some of these bugs could cause nightmares. I absolutely agree with you. I think if there was a change to the way the Earth was and all of a sudden these bugs started to evolve into bigger things, we would absolutely have some difficulty controlling ourselves here. It's actually been quite a lovely stroll today. We haven't seen much. I mean, we've been quite intrigued. We've been walking on this crest, and there hasn't been much in the way of action on these crests. We've seen some amazing thing, but yeah, nevertheless, I think it's time that Brent gives you an update on what he's been up to, and we'll carry on walking and see what we can find.
We are still in search of the Tallala lions. They're giving us quite the runaround. We're the only person here looking for them at the moment. And I'm gonna go check around this block again, and hopefully they've popped out. There's lots of impala and waterbuck here on the southern side of the block, and they haven't popped through. No problem, dude. Oh, cool. I'm sure we'll find them. I might take a walk just now. Yeah, I'm falling, John. You've weird. Yes. Okay, so that was the last car to see those lions somewhere in here. And they lost them as they went through a thick area. And we're going to go try now, see if they haven't come further west. We're going to do a big loop around. Lions, when they're hunting, tend to change direction quite a lot. And I know there's a lot of impala and waterbuck here, so they definitely haven't got this far, unless they're being really sneaky. Just want to double check all these big animal paths, see if they haven't snuck across. It wouldn't be exciting if we catch them on the hunt. We're in search of lions at the moment. We've been discussing lion vocalizations quite a bit earlier on in the safari. Now, Jim in Washington State is wondering, are the females sort of mute? Are the males the vocal ones? Both species are probably as vocal as each other. So the males are trying to keep other males away. The females are doing the same. So when a female's roar, and it's very difficult to actually tell the difference between a male and female roar unless you're very close. Lion stick. Lots of those out here. So, Jim, the females do call, and they do call to announce their territory to other females. So, for example, the Inkahumas will call to keep the Tsalalas out of their area, and the Tsalalas will do the same. So I'm guessing it was about opposite here where the last sight of them was. Quite frustrating when you know they're in the small area and you can't find them. I might take a gamble soon. Let's just check. Patience, Brent. Let's just check all the way around, although my gut is telling me there. And listening to my gut. I think I'm going to listen to my gut. My gut is telling me they're going to be around here. Don't know why. Can't say why. My gut is saying here, and saying right here. So let's hope my gut is on form this morning. So while we go off into the bush, let's go see what James is up to.
His gut is on form. Is that what he said? He said his gut was on form. Well, that is interesting. I don't know what that means, really. But I hope whatever it means that there'll be lions very soon. Now, let's have a look over here. Another pleasant or interesting museum piece. One, although it fits very nicely into the skull, is not actually from here. Now, this is a warthog, and there was a stage when I thought it was a hippopotamus, but we're not going to go into that rather embarrassing stage of my life. So this is a warthog skull, and I think it's probably from a big boar. And there's a few things I want to show you about it. Firstly, the size. So there it is next to my head. I don't have a substantial head, but it's not a particularly small one. And so they are big. They are very big. The other thing, of course, is this tusk. This warthog tusk, which actually slots very nicely in here. They're not from the same animal, but you can see it does fit, sort of. No, it's in the wrong way, isn't it, Brian? Where was it? Was it in there? Kirsten says I'm not very good at puzzles. Kirsten, you just be quiet and do your job there. There we go. It's in. See? Very nice. Now, you can see the point or the tip of this tusk is in fact very blunt. Completely blunt. See that, Brian?
Mm-hmm.
And if you look down over here, it'd be nice to find a kind of a bottom jaw, but we don't have one. Can you see how that is polished smooth? Completely polished smooth, and there's a ridge. There's a very sharp ridge just over there. And that ivory has been polished smooth by the bottom teeth. Now, all pigs have got this terrifying bottom canine, so it would be the equivalent of this tooth here, which is quite clean, so we can put it on camera. And it would occlude, so it rubs against the top tusk like this. And one of the major reasons for the top tusk is that it sharpens the bottom tooth. And if you're ever set upon by a pig, by a wild boar or even a warthog, it's that bottom tooth you've got to watch out for. They are razor, razor sharp because of the rubbing against the top like this. Right? Now, the other thing I want to show you is we have over here a young male leopard. And I would like to show you, people often ask, well, don't leopards eat warthogs? Well, the answer is they don't often eat warthogs, no. Well, not big warthogs. And the reason is very clear to see here. You can see that the warthog is far, far, far more massive than this male leopard. He's not as big as Tingana, this fellow. I'm going to put him at about 6 years old. So his skull would get slightly larger, but he'll never be the size of a male warthog like this. So for an animal, a predator, to take on a male warthog, they've really got to be pretty big or in a group. Now here's the big male lion, and there's the big male lion, and you can see his head is now roughly the same size as the warthog's. It's much heavier, and there's a lot more muscle on it, and a big male lion is obviously a lot heavier than a big male warthog, probably about twice the weight. But a male leopard, even though an enormous male leopard might come close to being similarly sized to a small male warthog, he's not going to take the risk. When there are other things around to eat, there's no reason for him to take the risk to try and kill something as enormous as this warthog, which I think is quite interesting. And then the other thing I wanted to show you were these other teeth. We were talking about teeth earlier, and I'm just going to empty out Leo Smith's little collection here, which it contains coins and various other things. But if I'm not mistaken, these, although they don't come from South African animals, they come from, if I'm not mistaken, a primate of the Gabonese rainforests, and I think a monkey species. Just look at the length and sharpness of this particular tooth. This is the canine tooth, right? Of a monkey. Probably the same size, a little bit bigger than a vervet monkey. Now, a vervet monkey, which we get out here, is a tiny, tiny thing. They probably weigh about 20 to 25 kilograms, that's all. But look at the size of the tooth. Now, if you happen to be a leopard, right, if you happen to be even this big male leopard, or this was quite a small male leopard, this tooth is, while not as massive, is as long and as sharp as your canine. So when we talk about baboons, and primates being attacked and set upon by predators, it is no surprise to me that very few of them are killed by leopards in this area when they have the other option. When they have the option of steenbok and duiker and impala to eat, why would you set upon something that could damage you with teeth like this? And I always think that's quite amazing. You do find that leopards will eat baboons and monkeys, normally though, in areas where there isn't anything else to eat because they have these huge teeth. And so it's always about risk and reward for the animals out here. And if you find an impala, which we don't have, I don't think we have an impala, we don't. We must try and find one. But when we find an impala and you can see the dentition it has, it's totally useless for defense. The female has no horns with which to defend herself. The sole defense is to watch out for predators and then to run away. But once you've got hold of one of those antelope, it's pretty much game over if you happen to be a big leopard or even a little leopard. Stefan seems to be having a bit of a rest. I think he's a bit tired. So let's go and find out what he's doing.
I'm not having a rest. I want to key out this track with you all. That's what I want to do. We've got two tracks here that are similar except for their size. We have this track here, as you can see, with a pointy side on this side. And then these two, let me just get my shadow out the way, and these two lobes on this side. And then we've got a very similar track just adjacent to it, right here. Also, pointy side on the side and two lobes. But they're obviously vastly different in size. There's my thumb next to it on this one, and here's my thumb next to this one. You can see that they are very different in size. Now, antelope have cloven hooves. They have a hoof that's been split, and their outside two toenails have basically fused together like this. The outside two toenails are fused together, and then these have become pointy where these have stayed the same. So they've split and become hard, and that gives them the ability to push into the sand and run fast. That's what the ability of these hooves, that's why they have these hooves. That's what's made them those hooves. Now I want to show you what I think this is. I think this is this hoof here of a wildebeest. And I want to try and see if I can show you the diagnostics of it. In other words, what we have got to show you here. So I think that right here, you can see over here, is that lobe. You have a slight depression there. You have this lobe on this side. Nice and round, nice round back of the pad. You can see that over here. Nice round back of the pad. However, now that I'm looking at it, it might also be the track of a waterbuck. Now that would obviously, while I'm trying to show you how clever I am, I might actually be talking myself out of what I think it is, which is quite possibly what happens here all the time. So let's go and have a look at waterbuck and see what we can see. So I'm busy paging through my tracking book here, as you can see. Trying to find waterbuck. Of course, the easiest thing would have been just to go to the key and then use the key, but that would have been way too easy. I need to battle, and that is the hallmark of it. Oh, should be getting there sometime soon. Puku, we've missed it. Common waterbuck. Definitely not, as you can see there. We lack that sharp edge on the back of the hoof. Definitely a wildebeest with that mark, round pad there, this big hoof, and that is about as big as my hand. And this little one on this side is that of an impala. Now impala have a very prominent ridge that goes through the middle of their cloven hooves. It's almost diagnostic of the impala. And in soft sand, that ridge there is very sharply defined. So the size, that ridge,
And then this very sharply defined edge in soft sand is what gives me the idea that that is exactly an impala. Both sprinters, both like to jog away from predators. In actual fact, can probably outpace predators over, say, a mile. Definitely out-jink them. And it's only really through ambush that the predators get to catch these guys. So lion and leopard really specialize. Lion obviously specialize in the bigger antelope, the wildebeest. Leopard obviously specialize in the impala-sized antelope. They both have not decided to chase after their prey like cheetah do. Both lion and leopard are ambush specialists. They will lie in wait, and when the animal comes past them, bound short, very sharp, very quick off the mark. That's why they're so stocky, to get that power off the mark, catch their prey, and bring it down to the ground. So that's how predators have overcome the speed advantage that these cloven-hoofed animals have. Alrighty. Let me put my backpack back in. And while I do that, I think it would be a good idea for you to go to Brent for an update.
Unfortunately, no luck with those Tsalala lions. And it's a very big section of bush between the roads there. But keep an eye on the Arethusa Dam cam. I'm pretty sure they're going to pop out for a drink at some point. Very frustrating for me to have to leave there, but the only reason I did is because I had those really fresh male leopard tracks heading towards Red Dam, which has got water in it at the moment. And I'm hoping that Mr. Tingana has or is going to pop up there for a drink now that it's a little bit warmer. Now, the first place I actually ever saw Mr. Tingana was on this road, and we're driving through the Murakani River system at the moment. And there's lovely big trees for leopards to lie in. So we're driving down this dry riverbed, and Painted Wolf would like to know, when was the last time any of these rivers flowed? Oof. Probably last year, January or February. They never really flow for an extended period. They flow for a very short time, a couple of hours, and then go down. Actually, the Murakani flowed for a very short period. Oh, not the whole river, just a section of it. They got a bit of rain, probably December last year. Lots of LE tracks around as well. But these little river systems, as I said, they flow very quickly and then they dry just as quickly. I think, I don't know, probably been a good long time since they flowed for more than a day. Probably, I'm not sure actually. And I'm sure some of our long-time viewers we'll be able to tell me when the last time one of these dry rivers. Oh, hello. Oh, beautiful Ellie Ball. Hello, mister. Look at that lovely Ellie Ball in his prime. Glorious ivory. I love the curved ivory like that. It's very, very picturesque. I said there were lots of elephant tracks around. Let me just sneak forward a little bit. Quite a few ellies I can hear just through the thickets. And it looks like this bull is in around with a breeding herd. Yeah, look at that. Look, just, I know it's not the best view, but look, there's a big elephant bull and there's a cow. You can see the massive size difference between the two. There we go. Look at that. Oh, I can hear some more elephants screaming in the distance. A You can see him swaying. He's actually scratching his head against the tree. Now, Dina is wondering, will local villagers dig in these little river systems for water or watch where Ellie's... Oh, now he's having... Looks like he's going to scratch his bottom. Here we go. Well, Dina, in this part of the world, no. There are water pipes and stuff in most of the villages. But in other parts of Africa, yes, where I used to live in southern Tanzania, people would dig where elephants have dug to get water. Well, it's a pity they're right in this very thick area. I'm hopefully going to move a little bit more into the open. Just to try reposition a bit better. Here we go. Hello, madam. There's that look at that big boy. Feeding off a russet bush willow at the moment. Oh, he looks like he's actually got more than one species in his mouth. So unfortunately, where we're sitting at the moment is right in the in a dip that is playing a bit of havoc with our comms. And if we go up below that tree there, where my finger is, so it's come to the left a bit. Just watch where my finger is. There we go. There's a little one also hiding. So there's quite a few elephants here. We can't see all of them. We can hear quite a few of them. But it sounds like there's some more up ahead, and hopefully they're in a bit more of an open area. I just have one last look at this boy. Look, as he turns perfectly for us, showing us his big teeth. So elephant tusks are modified in sizes. You can actually see the wear on it. So he's right tusked, so that's the tusk he uses to move different bits of bark or scrape along the trees to remove it. You can see it's slightly rounded on the tip, not pointy. That's his working tusk. Incredible how evolution has modified that incisor to become an incredible weapon. So the bulls generally have bigger tusks because they use them for fighting, for mating rights, and also much thicker. What's he eating now? Looks like a little spike thorn. It's a bit far for me to see. Yes, yeah, a little spike thorn. Oh, he's just magnificent. Now, in his prime, I'm guessing he's probably late 30s. You can see how he's plucking that spike thorn, using that incredibly dexterous trunk of his. Now there's over 100,000 muscles in an elephant's trunk. And he's got a little goatee as well. You can see lots of those. There we go. Look how, oh, he's ambi-tusked. See how he used his left tusk there just to bend and make it a bit easier to break. Let me just move forward a skosh. And he's being quite becoming, coming out into the open for us. But there you can also see the difference in the length. His tusks are nice and even, but you can see the right tusk is a little bit shorter. So he uses that more often than his left tusk when feeding. When I was sniffing around looking for the tastiest morsel that's there, he's got a little vine. I think that's probably difficult to say at this distance, but more than likely a rhesus vine or a bushman's grape.
He's feeding around. Oh, bye-bye, tree.
Look at that incredible power. He barely pushed it.
And that was the end of the poor little jackalberry. And the funny thing is, I don't think he's doing that for the tree itself. They don't really eat jackalberry too often, but actually going after the vine that's in the tree. He's moving all the dead branches out of the way to get to what he wants. Truly are gentle giants. Well, not so gentle if you're a tree. Sorry if you heard a funny noise there. I knelt on my iPad and it started looking for Siri, but we don't have Siri out here in the middle of the bush. She doesn't quite get into the drainage lines. I just love spending time with these big bulls. Now, if we come out a little bit, we're going to have a look how massive he is. And let me find my hand there. In particular, I want you to look how big his legs are. And speaking of elephant legs, let's go see what James has got in the tent.
Brian, you see how strong I am.
Oh, so strong.
I'm so powerful.
Immense.
Everybody, this is the back leg, the back femur, if I'm not mistaken. Is that correct? I'm just going to go through my... No, it's not the femur, it's the tibia. This is the tibia of a large elephant bull. Now, when you look at an elephant bull's back leg, and compared with my very shapely leg, you see how shapely my leg is, Brian?
So shapely.
It's so shapely. The femur... in an elephant is actually quite a lot smaller than you think it is. But that long bone leading to what looks like the knee joint, but isn't in fact the knee joint, is... No, I'm talking absolute rubbish. I'm getting completely confused. No, it is. It's the femur. This is the femur. So it would be in the same place that it is for us. I'm getting confused between this and a carnivore, which has a slightly different arrangement. Same arrangement, but different lengths of... lengths of bone. Anyway, so the elephant's femur is the same length as my entire leg. I'm not a very large fellow, but Brian is probably about the same as your leg as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's really rather impressive. That, I think, is the bottom and attaches to the patella. This, I imagine, is the hip bone and will attach with a ball and socket to the hip, which in turn will attach to the pelvis. And that is how the elephant will get around. But what I do think is so interesting is how dense it is. It is a massively heavy thing, this. And an elephant, of course, does not move with the greatest level of athleticism that you've ever seen before. And that's because their bones are very heavy. They're not able to withstand, they can't jump, for example. They're the only mammal we know of that is, well, other than the cetaceans, which live in the sea, that are actually unable to jump at all. So they power walk. And if you have legs like this, you're unable to run. You have to power walk rather than run. Now, just on the subject of bones. Let me put this back. Kathy, Patty, you're asking about ivory and what differentiates elephant ivory from other tooth ivory, and are all teeth made of ivory? There's no difference. No difference at all. I'm sure there's slight chemical difference, but basically it's the same. So if we take, where's our warthog pal? Here he is. If we take this warthog ivory is absolutely workable in the same way that the ivory of an elephant is workable, but it's much smaller. And so you cannot work it into anything like the same kind of thing that you can, the elephant ivory. I mean, an elephant tusk would be roughly that fat at the base. So, you know, those big elephant tuskers had tusks that weighed sometimes up to 100 pounds, I think 80 to 100 pounds, which is enormous. You can imagine the amount that you could carve out of something like that. So it is ivory, absolutely. The other thing is that if you look into the tooth like this, you can see where the nerve went. And so it's actually only solid ivory for very sort of small areas. And I suppose if you look at the difference between this tooth and, say, this herbivore's tooth, I guess the ivory would be considered the enamel part of it, which is the outer covering. It's not that inner part of a tooth like that you can see there. That wouldn't be considered ivory, and so I guess that's probably why we don't find little trinkets carved out of human teeth or any other kind of teeth, because you have this kind of broken up form where only the outer covering is the ivory or the enamel. But essentially it's the same thing. Yeah, there's nothing unusual, particularly unusual chemically, about an elephant's teeth. I wanted to show you one other thing quickly. I've now confused myself entirely. Oh yes, it was about this giraffe. And what I wanted to show you about it is not so much the fact that this giraffe's done a lot of TV service, by the way. But what it's got, we know that these things are called ossicones or horns, and they're slightly different from real horns in that I think that they, because they grow from the base, you can see where they've joined onto the skull. They're not actually part of the skull, they fuse onto the skull as cartilage. Now there's an animal in North America that I bet many of you didn't realize was doing this. Oh my goodness, I'm going to show you something else here, which is the pronghorn. Now the pronghorn antelope is actually quite closely related to a giraffe, well, in distant prehistory, and their horns are very similar to these ossicones, which differ from deer's antlers and antelope's horns. Just look over here, Brian. Can you see this? I just watched a little wasp go in there. There's a wasp living in this skull. What kind of wasp it is, I couldn't begin to tell you. But while I try and find out, let's head across to Stefan, who is not sitting this time, but squatting.
James, is the most wonderful way of giving me yes, I am squatting, but it's not because of anything else except for me wanting to figure out what type of beetle is busy eating this purple panweed. Now, have a look at that. This bronze-colored beetle that's busy feeding on the sap of this purple panweed. Now, purple panweed grows in areas that have a lot of water, and we imagine that they've got quite a lot of sap to it. And this beetle is taking advantage of that particular sap. Let me just get him into the sun there for you. By tapping into the mid vein on this particular leaf and sucking up the juice. What beetle it is, I have absolutely no idea. Just grabbed my interest now. I wanted to see what has been eating this. And it's actually creating a wilt on this purple panweed. I'm going to leave it open like that. You can actually see that the plant itself doesn't look healthy. And that, as I think, is as a result of being inundated by these beetles. There's only one beetle on this particular plant at the moment, and yes, it is dry, so I would expect this panweed to wilt. It's a type of sedge that has singularly one of the most pleasant smells out here. And as James quite aptly pointed out, if I were to go and squat somewhere here, I would do it here because of the air freshener that was provided kindly by Mother Nature. Oh, it's got the most unbelievably camphory smell. Now you, of course, won't be able to smell it from where you're sitting. And unfortunately, they haven't developed scratch and sniff TVs yet. But it's quite juicy. And the smell is this whack of menthol, camphor. Probably the most prominent one is camphor with a bit of mint. So if I were to describe the smell to you, take a jar of camphor cream and crush 2 or 3 leaves of mint into it.
That is what this purple panweed smells like. A very, very pleasant smell. I quite enjoy it. Now, I'm on the search for a nest of the Polyrhynchus ant, which is one of my favorites. And I've seen one or two of them working themselves through the canopy between here and basically where you're standing at the moment. Ah, here we've got a pansy butterfly that is going to make life for VM very difficult. That is a blue pansy butterfly. And have a look. It's warm enough for them to flit around. Camouflaged with the wings closed. They obviously saw VM's movement. Closed up the wings very quickly and now is opening up those wings to collect sunlight and to display. They're quite aggressive little butterflies. And they're opening up. And look at those massively bold markings. Now we're trying carefully not to move. Butterflies have got very good eyesight in actual fact. And what happened there was as it closed, there we go, closing the wings, open, closed. That's not trying to hide, that's a different behavior. But nevertheless, when she closes her wings, she disappears amongst that leaf litter. Isn't that amazing? And then as soon as she opens up her wings again, bam, you get hit with a color. There she's almost completely disappeared from where I'm standing, which is just behind where you are at the moment. I almost cannot see her. Now those wings are covered in tiny little scales, and those scales have been studied at a microscopic level, and they've got specific shapes that are very light reflective. And what cosmetic companies have recently decided to do was make their particles that they put color onto for, in particular, eyeliner and certain facial powders, the same structure as the scales on the wings of a butterfly. Oops, there she goes. And so what they've done is they've introduced their color particles or their color dye to particles in their powder and in their eyeliner that is the shape of the butterfly's wings. And what it's doing is it's increasing, eyeshadow, sorry, just been told by Kirsty it's eyeshadow. And what it does is it increases reflectivity and gives the eye a more brilliant shine and obviously makes it look nicer and pretty. I have no experience in that, barring my sister growing up on pain of death, me playing with her stuff. Or tampering with it, not really playing with it. Alright, now back to my search for Polyrhynchus ant. I quite enjoy their nests. They thatch the entrance of their nests. Now that's quite a bizarre concept to think about. An ant nest, the entrance. Ah, here we go. But before we do that, let's see if you can get this. Hang on. Okay, if we zoom in right at the end of my barrel. Oh, let's see if we can get him on that leaf there, VM. No, these are not going to play with. That was a bee fly. I'm going to see if I can get him again for us. Let's see. VM, I'm going to put it. No, not working.